Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon. Thank you, Dwe and Lydia. This afternoon, I would like to begin by thanking Project Director Sharidan. Where you? You still here? Sharidan? And Johan and Afiq, yeah? And also Nurin. These are the key players the whole of today. So let me have my team in meeting. Thank you. And above all, participants, the 190 of you, understand there were more this morning. There's been some depression, whatever reason. But for those of you who stayed the whole morning and afternoon, let me thank you for your commitment to this very important subject. My team, led by Dato' Jaya, has gone through the details. It was not my intention to go through them once again. Yeah. My purpose come here today is to say hello to you. Hi, hello everyone. Say hello to you and to of course say thank you and to get some feedback. A few moments ago I was with 7-8 of you. They shared with me your part of your team. Sat down in a small room over there with me. I asked them for feedback. But we're doing quite a bit more of this. For your information, end of January, going to Parliament. So we've got a small window, Christmas and New Year. Yeah? How many of you are celebrating Christmas? Many are, I'm sure. Yeah? You're not Christians, but many are taking a short break. So we've got this challenge, yeah, between now and perhaps end of the year. Nothing much will happen. So from my point of view, we've got this big challenge of doing this, you know, outreach. We've done a lot, probably 150, 200 in the last 4 or 5 years. I did one a few days ago, today, doing another one next Monday, Tuesday, you know, you name it. There's more to come. So we got this very small window between now and end of January before it goes to Parliament. So my intention of encouraging my team to talk to young people, various organizations, to ensure that by the time it goes to Parliament, many Malaysians understand what this whole thing, what the scripture is all about, scripture called TPP. When we were over there just now, one feedback I got, a few, you know, inputs were given to me, among others, the need for us to simplify, to bring this to the ground, to the man on the street. What does it mean to a farmer, to a fedah settler, someone operating a small store by the roadside? So I think I would like to thank you for that. We are aware that we need to do a lot more in order to simplify, make it easily understood. Yeah? We want every Malaysian, and it's not fair for the government minister to push a major initiative without getting the buy-in support of as many Malaysians as possible. Of course, from the government's point of view, as you all know, this is important for us. We believe if we are not part of this trade deal, we are going to be left out. That's our view. We're going to lose out. Yeah? You know, if you ask me what my fear has been in the last 5 years, it is this, that come, in the event we're not part of this deal, come 2020, 2025, when say 15, 20 countries are part of TPP and we're not part of TPP. So that's my biggest fear. Yeah? In the event we're left out, say 20 countries are members, 2020 or 2025, we're not part of TPP. I think, in my view, I'm convinced that we will lose out in this game of competition. So that's my fear. Anyway, today I'm not here to go over substantive issues. You have gone through all that. Let me share with you my experience in dealing with these negotiations in the last 5 years. Dato' Jaya, is our chief negotiator. He's been assisted by 21 other key people whom we call leads. These are experts in various fields, agriculture, market access, IT, medicine, government procurement. So 21 of them. Under him, there are 21 individuals in the last 5 years who've been busy working with other partners we have from the other 11 countries. I became intensively involved in this 3 years ago. Yeah, before that, Dato' Jaya and his team has been doing all the work. I came in a bit later. In any negotiation, you deal with the simple things first, towards the end. Yeah, I must say, we were probably the most difficult country. Comparing Malaysia with other countries, we were the toughest nut to crack was Malaysia. Yeah, people say we were stubborn, recalcitrant, we were unreasonable, all kinds of labels given to us. Yeah? I think it's quite true to some extent to say that negotiations were delayed partly because of Malaysia. Yeah? For some countries, Singapore is not a problem. Singapore has already got an FTA with US, with EU, it is already an open economy. Singapore is open to the world, open to investors, to traders, banking, services. So Singapore, you know, it was plain sailing for Singapore. For Malaysia, as you know, negotiations were concluded on the 5th of October. And what we decided, because a number of issues were unresolved on that day. So what was decided by negotiators was that we wanted to do a few things, what we call at rest. Yeah? These are issues which we told them we had to carry home. I had to bring to my cabinet, a full cabinet meeting, to get the mandate of cabinet. These are issues for which I did not get a mandate from cabinet. So every time I go out to negotiate, I would go to cabinet and I would seek cabinet endorsement. On those issues, that's not a problem. But on those four or five issues, there's no mandate. That's got to do with state-owned enterprises, that's got to do with labor issues, three or four issues altogether. And when we're in Atlanta, we were told to come back to the other TPP parties within about a week. And as it turned out, it took us about 3 weeks before we made a decision, and they had to wait for us. Yeah? And at least on two occasions, a few teams came to Malaysia, yeah, asking us what was our position on those issues. Anyway, after 3 weeks, yeah, I went to cabinet. I brought the key people with whom we're having some major challenges to brief the cabinet. And at the end, we made a decision. And that was partly why the TPP was a bit delayed. The 5th of October, it was concluded, negotiations concluded, and the text only came out on the 5th of November 2015, basically. So that's a chronology. And the other issue I want to share with you, so point number one is that Malaysia, on a ranking of 1 to 12, we were number 12. With the greatest degree of difficulty, yeah? Singapore and others, it's not a problem. Vietnam, I would say, has got some issues, not as many as Malaysia. Brunei has got some, very limited number of issues. Chile and Peru has got some, yeah? New Zealand, but we had the most number of problems. So that's point number one I would like to share with you. It's not easy, but we're able to promote our agenda. We're able to, by and large, protect our interests. Number two, this issue of secrecy, yeah? Lack of transparency. In any negotiation, yeah, it is impossible for us to expose the goings on for the world. If you negotiate, of course, there's got to be some confidentiality. That's been a big issue, not only in Malaysia, throughout the world. It was in 2012, right? We brought this in Brunei. Because of my intervention, a special meeting was convened at the home of the Japanese ambassador in Brunei. There was this round, there was this meeting of ministers in Brunei, which I attended. Yeah. I fought hard for the issue of transparency to be discussed. And for the first time, yeah, because of my intervention, we discussed transparency, how to go forward, how open can we be, yeah, with our congressmen, our members of parliament. We've been championing this issue, but of course there are limitations. We all agree that it's possible to open up. What we need was, we decided in the case of Malaysia to start a process called the Cleared Advisors. We set up a group of people, about 30 of them. These are experts, various fields, some of them academics, some of them industrialists, some of them belonging to think tanks, 30 of them, we appointed them to be what we call clerk advisors. So we shared with them the text, the detailed negotiating position. So we did that in order to satisfy the demands from the public for greater transparency. Next, we also had this request from members of parliament, especially the opposition, that there should be a committee set up within parliament to deal with TPP. We agreed to that, and we set up what we call the bipartisan caucus of parliament, comprising of 11 members, 6 from Barisan Nasional and 5 from the opposition. We have been very fair. Most times, the opposition ranks outnumbered people coming from the government. But anyway, it's 6 and 5. 6 from BN and 5 from the opposition. And with them, we shared a lot more information than we did with the general public. Yeah? We actually shared with them our detailed negotiating position. Not the text, but our negotiating position, one by one. And we had lots of comments from them. We met 15 times altogether. This caucus was disbanded about 3 weeks ago. Yeah? We started about two years ago. We've been meeting. We met for 15 times, and this caucus was disbanded about 3 weeks ago. And to me, this is unprecedented. There's not too many presidents in Malaysian parliamentary history where members, the government and opposition sit around the table. I'll be, you know, giving a presentation. There'll be a lot of Q&A. Normally, we'll meet for about 2 hours. Yeah. There was one particular meeting, I was about to fly, I can't remember where it was, but 2 years ago, I had to have a meeting at the airport, you know. Such was the importance I gave to this caucus, yeah? I was about to fly, there was no time. Okay, I told them, before I board the plane, I see you. And we had this meeting at the, what we call this hotel the airport, Rama Rama, used to be called Pan Pacific, and Sama Sama. So this meeting was... This meeting was held about 2 years ago at the Sama Sama Hotel at the airport. Yeah? So, in my view, this process has resulted in, you know, in the government being able to communicate with the opposition. I must say, opposition doesn't come only from the opposition members, but also from members of the Barisan Nasional. So that's something that I thought is very important to share. Finally, in my view, I mean, the most difficult for me was 1st August 2013. I had a town hall meeting. That was in my great building. Some of you, who was there? 1st August 2013. That was more than 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago. There were more than 1,000 people. That was the first town hall I had on TPP. Before that, it's been closed door, you know, briefings like this. But that was my first attempt at having town hall. TPP, 1st August 2013, more than 1,000 people. There were 32 questions on the TPP. I answered all of them. 31 were against it. Only one was neutral. Not a single question was tending towards the government's position. So we started from a position where members of the Malaysian public were very antagonistic, not very happy with TPP, not very happy with the lack of transparency. But I just want to share with you that in the last 2 years, in my view, we've been able to communicate, and there is now better understanding of TPP compared to the position, say, the first town hall I had on the 1st of August 2013. I have since had many town halls. I've been to 5 states, I was in Sabah, Kelantan, Kedah, Shah Alam. I had 2 in KL. And they all town halls, Kelantan for 800 people, Kedah, 100 people, Sabah, 500 people, Shah Alam, 400, 500. These are open discussions. I've been going everywhere, and that's what we've done. So, in my view, the opposition towards TPP has got to do with a number of factors. One is lack of information. One is ideological. Another is American and multinational. Some Jews, so for some people, is US multinational Jews in that order. Eh? This is American, this is multinational and Jews. So that's one group of people. Some has got legitimate concerns, national sovereignty, CPI, cost of living. Yeah? But in my view, a lot of the opposition has got to do with lack of information. There's been a lot of spinning, which I think it's very, it's quite unethical. For example, Obama was here, and he had a, I wasn't there, I was there when he spoke at Shangri-La before this people, attended by 800 people. He spoke about, about half an hour, 20 minutes was about TPP, yeah? And of course, he was articulating the American position. It wasn't apologetic. He said, this is in America's interest, yeah? To do TPP. So there was one, I think he met a few students somewhere, and there was a question about press medicine. Because here in this country, yeah, there's a recent, I don't know whether you call it block, whatever it is, there's a guy who said the cost of one particular medicine to treat diabetes, now it's about 200 ringgit, TPP will bring this to 2,000 ringgit. And there are many Malaysians who believe in this story. And Obama was the same question was asked. Obama did not quite answer that directly, but you know, I think what he said was that the TPP will not have an impact on the price of medicine. But Malaysia Kini came to the story to say that price of medicine will go up. An insider said Obama at that same engagement told the crowd that the price of medicine will come down. So you have two different newsporters attending the same function. Malaysia Kini saying Obama. Attributing that statement to Obama, saying that the price of medicine will go up. Insider said that Obama said the price of medicine will go down. So when Obama said nothing of that sort, the American embassy came up and did the talk to the two portals, and there was some kind of correction. But anyway, my point is, Obama never said that the price of medicine was going to go up. But there are people in this country who, to this very day, yeah, in my Facebook and other places, I say that. We've been saying, beforehand explained to you this morning, that our view, yeah, if we're not changing our policy on patents, protection remains 20 years, and data exclusivity for biologics is 5 years, that's our position. And now we have for small molecules, 5 years. Yes, it's correct, for biologics, we haven't got that yet, but for small molecules, we already have 5 years. So the current policy is going to be applied to biology. So in our view, TPP is not going to do anything to the price of medicine. But I continue to have this view coming from many places that TPP will result in a big increase in the price of medicines. There's one particular person who said, you know, from 200, it's going to go up to 1,000 ringgit. So it's been a bit of misinformation. Some concerns are quite legitimate. For example, small, medium enterprises are quite worried that they could face stiffer competition, for example, oil and gas, yeah, and that was also highlighted in the both PwC and IC study. Yeah, you open up 12 sectors to foreign participation, TPP countries. Yeah, what Petronas did was that in the case of this 12, it is already and there's no Malaysian participation. So what they've done is to choose sectors where these are very high-end activities requiring high-tech. High-tech kind of technology. So these are areas where there's such Malaysian participation. So Petronas decided to open up those 12 sectors. So both PwC and I should say that there's going to be more intense competition in the oil and gas sector. So one thing is this, the government recognizes that there are upside and downside. There are pros and cons. Anything that you do, yeah, there are upside and downside. I don't think I'll go to my PowerPoint. Let's see how it goes. But anyway, I'm sharing with you, yeah, my experience dealing with this. I must say it's been the most challenging period of my career. Yeah? And now they say TPP is Istopa, yeah? It's my name. TPP, I don't mind that. Yeah? But in my view, in my honest opinion, if you're not part of TPP, come 2020 or 2025, when you know, now 5 countries say open that they want to be part of TPP. Now that's, say, Malaysia's out, and they have 11 plus 5, 16, yeah? And out of it, in my honest view, there will be a time when we might regret not being part of this process. So if you ask me what motivates me to push the envelope, walk this far, to get this deal done, one is, in my view, this the best interest of Malaysia. As an open economy, a country which is dependent on trade investments, and secondly, what has motivated me is this fear that in the event more countries on board and do not part the sea, then my view as open economy, Malaysia is sent again. Yeah, there is a very important point which I have been saying everywhere, is the fact that Malaysians are strong overseas. In the same way that you want to protect foreign investors in this country, you want Malaysian investors to be protected outside. Okay? The latest numbers for September 2015 indicate that we have 600 billion ringgit worth of Malaysian investments overseas. 600 billion ringgit. And foreign investments in this country, as of September this year, was 500 billion. So there's a gap 100 billion. Yeah? The investments we have in Indonesia, in Australia, New Zealand, some of our Sarawak companies own forest concessions in New Zealand, which is a TPP country. Malaysians are quite big in New Zealand. Yeah? Malaysians are big in Australia. There's a ratio of 5 to 1. For every dollar that Aussies have in Malaysia, we have $5 in Australia. For every dollar that Aussies have in Malaysia, we have $5 in Australia. Yeah? As PM has said many times, yeah? The biggest foreign investment in Canada comes from PETNAS, $36 billion Canadian dollars. So this is a point which many people are not aware, or they've chosen not to be aware of, which is Malaysia has a huge presence overseas. If Malaysia is number one in Brunei, you might share, I mean, Malaysians are building houses in Brunei, medium cost, low cost, Malaysians are building bridges and roads in Brunei. Malaysians are big in Singapore, the banks, their Khazanah is there. Malaysians are in Japan as well. We have hotels, golf course. Malaysians big in America. I think our Genting is number two gambling company in America. But this example, I cannot be highlighting in other places. You are a bit more open than other people. Huh? But that's a fact. Yeah? That's a fact. That Malaysians, so I just want this point to acknowledge the fact that Malaysia is strong overseas. 600 billion we have, ringgit. We have 500 billion of American, Singapore, Japanese money descent. So we have been a net exporter of capital. And in the same way, I mean, if you say Americans are coming here, they're taking over our country, we're going to be recolonized. What do the others say about us? What do Indonesians, TV country, Australia, New Zealand, or Canada for that matter? I mean, if you say that we're going to be recolonized, then Malaysia will be colonizing those countries. I mean, that's logic, right? Yeah? I've been saying that. Huh? So this is a very important point. Because the fact is EPF and PNB and Tabung Haji and CIMB and Maybank, I mean, we only have 30 million people. We have a market, a big market, but there are more opportunities. Yeah? You talk to your friends in EPF, they'll tell you that EPF would continue investing only in government securities, government papers. Then papers give you 4-5%. EPF dividends will never go up to 6-7%. Last year it was 6%, was it? Or roughly? Yeah? 6.75. And that was because of EPF's investment overseas. The fact is, some investment overseas, some, not all, huh? I mean, depending who your investment manager is, yeah? Some investments overseas have been yielding better returns. So EPF was able to declare a dividend of 6.5% last year. That was partly because of its investment overseas. Petronas has been able to declare high dividend, of course, price I don't know. That's because Petronas is big. Petronas is big now, a TPP country. Petronas is going to be big in Canada. Petronas is quite big in Australia, TPP country. Petronas has developed a partnership with Mexico, with Pemex. Yeah? So Petronas is another company which is earning lots of its profits from overseas operations. So these are some considerations why, in my view, it's very important for us to be part of TPP. Let's go through to see whether I'm start. The next. The other is standard. TPP is also about standard, about governance, enforcement of rules and regulations. Volkswagen, they cheated on carbon emissions and the market is penalized. Share prices came down. Yeah, they had to leave, I mean, the senior management had to leave the organization. Yeah. EPA of America, decided that Volkswagen, and it was acknowledged by Volkswagen, that they've cheated the consumer. Yeah. How many million cars together? 11 million. For and they were losing a lot. So standard. In Bangladesh, 2015, this place called Rana, the building, a few textile companies were there. 1,100 people perished. And as a result of that incident, yeah, companies in America and Europe decided to impose standards, labor standards on Bangladesh textile operators. And now, not all companies in Bangladesh have been able to meet the standards. So standard, TPP, also about standard. And what's wrong with having transparency, governance, enforcing your environmental laws? What's wrong preserving Cameron Highlands, for example? So TPP is about enforcing your rules regulations. Yeah? So these human rights, or human trafficking. We were tier three. Tier three means yeah, employer will keep passport, employer will not allow you to change employment, yeah? Employer sometimes delay your salary, yeah? Few weeks. Yeah? So we've been put in tier three. So TPP is about giving some minimum rights to foreign workers. And I think what they found this time in Penang and other places, although it's not pervasive, but you have a few of these cases, that's enough, yeah? Enough for us to be put in tier three. Now, of course, we're in tier two. So TPP is also about giving minimum rights to workers. What's wrong with giving workers minimum rights? Okay. We are, of course, an open economy, yeah? GDP, trade gap ratio of 1.5%. These are our trading partners, China. Yeah. Okay, I've spoken about. You look at history, economic history. China developed after 1978, Deng Xiaoping. But more so, China became open to the world since 2001, yeah, when it became a member of the WTO. 2001. That's when China began to welcome foreign investment. China became a big trading nation, and now China is now number one, number two in the world. Germany is number one. I think now China, I haven't got my latest numbers, but China is now the second biggest economy in the world. By terms of trade, China's trade is more than $4 trillion. Yeah. So China, in my view, I've been telling this story in many places. Yeah. The first time I was lucky, because the first time I went to China was 1955, and the second time was 2007. China was all Mao suits. They were riding bicycles. No traffic jam. Yeah? There's only one store called the Friendship Store. That's where most people went to buy their souvenirs. But China, I went second time in China, 2007. Well, 20 years later. And I couldn't believe my eyes what I saw. The infrastructure, the high speed rail, the airport, yeah? The traffic jam, and in the view. Yeah? And of course, the red alert last week. I think they're trying to. The police, the French, as you know, today they're supposed to come up with. So have they reached an agreement? There's a draft on the table. President Hollande is trying to get this done. The climate conference. So China was trying to impress Europe. The 190 countries are in Paris now. They are trying to get an agreement on climate change. So last year, I think last week, Tuesday, China declared Beijing. Put on red alert. So 2001. China became a member of WTO. They have a meeting beginning tomorrow. I'm leaving my house about 6:30 this evening to attend the WTO meeting in Nairobi. Yeah? So some people say, why wouldn't TPP? Why don't you do WTO? Yes, WTO is good. WTO is 163 countries. Yeah? There's an even playing field. It's good. But WTO has not delivered. I know I've been part of it. I used to chair. I was vice chairman of the WTO in 2011. I was in Geneva. This was a meeting of all great ministers. I was the chair. But the chair, I mean, by being vice chairman, of course, you've got to take the position when the chair is not there. And we have been active members of WTO. We've been one of the founding members of WTO. The fact is, WTO has not been working. You know? 14 years, we've been working on the Doha Development Round. Doha Development Round is about giving more benefits to the developing world. But we're not moving. There was a meeting. Yeah, there was a meeting of ASEAN 27 summit 3 weeks ago. Ended there, and we had a briefing by a few people. It was before that in APEC. We had a deputy DG. I was there in Manila 3 weeks ago to attend the meeting of APEC. Briefing by the WTO deputy DG. WTO is not moving, and we're going to Nairobi. Maybe in the next couple of hours. We're not too sure what the outcome is going to be. So there are people in this country who have been telling me, why you go this route? Why are you doing all this bilateral? You go to WTO route. I mean, I'm sure these are intelligent people. They know that WTO is not working because this is 160 countries. Yeah? How can you bring together the least developed countries of Africa, America, Japan? It's impossible. I know because I was chairing some meeting in the year 2011. Yeah? So yes, WTO is the first best solution. WTO, where everyone's got a voice. Yeah, yeah, yes. Yeah? TPP is an exclusive club. Why China is not part of China? Well, partly because China probably cannot meet the standard. Even Malaysia has got problems. I mean, country like Malaysia, we were the last to come in, in TPP in terms of agreement. Yeah? China, IP for example, China, you invent something, in the next 2 seconds, you'll be producing something. Yeah, China. So, which China acknowledges. Yeah? So, standard in China, labor law in China, for example. We don't think that China will, it's not that China cannot be part of this, but we believe that China is not ready. Labor law, IP, very poor IP protection. Yeah, it's not well. Some people might say this is a deliberate effort to exclude China, but the fact is China cannot meet understand. Okay, now China is the biggest market for cars. America was number one. Now 1/4 of cars produced and bought in the world now is being produced and bought in China. Okay, 1/4. Before this, America was number one, but the top three. I think it's GM, Toyota, Volkswagen, and that order. Yeah? Top three are foreign companies and Chinese companies, number four, number five. It's not a big issue with China because China is open. I think China is probably more open than Malaysia. I think, yeah? Cars, yeah? 1, 2, 3 are foreign cars. Yeah? A Chinese car, a Geely, and the other one is Great Wall, number four, number five. Yeah? So China is not the biggest market for cars. Why? China is open to the world. Foreign companies are there. The market is open for foreign companies. And that's why China is able to develop. And you look at Singapore. Singapore's got nothing, not a single drop of oil. But it's one of the biggest producers of refined oil in the world. Yeah, Singapore is spot number two in the world. Yeah? And Singapore is open. Open to banks, open to professionals. Lots of Malaysian professionals are working there. How many of you are working in Singapore? How many of you used to work in Singapore? There are many Malaysians there, eh? You know this. Probably a few hundred thousand, yeah? And Singapore is doing well because it's open. It's too open. It's causing a lot of problems in Singapore. Yeah, too many Chinese, too many Indians now. The recent immigrants, yeah? Vietnam, okay, next. And not many people are aware of that. Singapore has got a higher per capita income than US now, you know? And now, from last year onwards, Singapore's per capita income was higher than that of America. So Singapore has overtaken America in terms of per capita income, and that's because of its openness. Next. Of course, there are costs. Yeah? Qatar, I'm translating Qatar for 3 hours tonight. Yeah? Qatar, only 20% of its population are local Qataris. 80% are Indians, Pakistanis. There are 2,000 Malaysians there with their families and all five. Yeah? When I mentioned this to the deputy minister was there last week to see me. I said 2,000. No, there are 4,000 Malaysians. Anyway, whatever number is, there are many Malaysians working in Qatar. Yeah? So Qatar is only about 20% local. There is a foreign. It is a costly country. Cost in terms of social. I mean, you look at Petaling Street. You look at Chowkit. The Chowkit has been taken over, you know, by foreigners. Petaling Street. Some of our hills have been taken over by foreigners. But that's got nothing to do with policy. That's got to do with enforcement, right? Enforcement. Our policy is very clear, but corruption and all the same, yeah? They say for every halal worker in this country, foreign worker, there's another at least one haram, yeah? So, okay, whatever, yeah? So that's the cost, yeah? But globalization is inevitable. It's coming your way. I mean, you can't stop the internet. You can't stop foreign travel, yeah? You can't stop flow of capital. It is inevitable. You can apply brakes, but it's something that you can't avoid. Okay, next. Okay. Anything that you do, that costs a benefit. Global warming. You are now there working on 1.5%. Yeah. Before this, they wanted to increase temperature to 2 degrees. Now they're working 1.5. We hope they will achieve that. Yeah? If you implement that, of course, it is a cost to some countries. But it's for greater good. Some countries might have to stop production. China, they stop the factories. For a day or so last week, yeah? It is a cost. People might be losing a job. but you're doing this for the greater good. Anything that you do, there's cost and benefit. And TPP is no exception. Yeah? TPP has got some costs. I never say that TPP is a perfect, smooth sailing. No, I never say that. Yeah? There are costs involved. But as a government, next. Sabah and Sarawak, you know, for Malaysia with Malaya. There are costs to Sabah and Sarawak. They cost you as well. I want to go to Kuching or KK. I walk to immigration. They ask me for my passport. Hey, guy, I'm a Malaysian. Yeah, but they told me we have our own immigration law here. Yeah? So that's the cost one. Yeah? If you're a lawyer, you want to practice in Sabah Sarawak, you need to get the bar counsel in those states to approve. What's this? That's nonsense. But the cost we have to do, that's the price we have to pay. Yeah? Getting Sabah and Sarawak to be with us in Malaysia. Next. Okay. This is why government comes to, that's market failure. Okay? Anywhere in the world is market failure. This happens in America, this happens in Singapore, in Malaysia. Singapore, it was a big issue. Yeah? People bought them here, P40, Thomas Piketty. Yeah? The economist, the French economist came up with this issue of people who are being marginalized here, yeah? Because of globalization. So that's the role of government. Government's got to do capacity building. There are people who might be falling behind. There are people who want to depend on subsidies all the time. There are people who are sleeping and they expect government to help them in perpetuity until, yeah, time immemorial. So there are laggards. I mean, we have, not, and there are people who are handicapped. That's the role of government. The role of government is to correct market for that. Yeah? So globalization is inevitable. You can escape, you know. For Malaysia, you can escape. Malaysia be part of this smaller world. And there are costs with and the role of government is to correct those imperfections. Yeah? The role of government is to make sure that we distribute wealth to the needy, the poor, the B40, which is a very important asset policy. But for the government, we've got to look at things in the, TPP has got at least 20 major items. If I'm looking only from my point of view, of course, nothing will get done. Yeah? There are 20 items. I say, no, you have to follow me. The other guy says, no, you have to follow me. And nothing gets done. As a government, we've got to look all in totality, all the 20 items, yeah, on the table in totality, and we've got to do a cost benefit analysis, which we've done. Yeah? And if it benefits us, we'll go ahead. If the cost exceeds the benefits, of course, you're stupid. You don't go ahead to that. Huh? Okay, I think the rest are, I think, have been covered by Jaya and team. So I just want to share with you the philosophical underpinnings of TPP. We have been open. Melaka is doing. Did well before, and now Malacca is one of the most rapidly developing states. Malacca is already a developed state. If you ask me, which state in Malaysia is developed, it'll be Malacca. Yeah? Penang declared itself developed, but there are pockets of poverty in Penang. Selangor declared itself developed, I think 5-6 years ago, but there are pockets of poverty everywhere. Yeah? But if you ask me, which state is already developed, that will be Malacca. Yeah? And the rest of Malaysia, Sabah, Sarawak, there's a lot that we need to do. Yeah? Long time where I come from. Yeah? So this is the role of government. The role of government is to make sure that the bottom 40, yeah, the poor people are helped through various capacity building programs. So I've shared with you the philosophy behind TPP, the need to be open, the experience with China, became a member of WTO 2001, Singapore, WTO, WTO has failed. That has been there a long time. Of course, that would be the first best solution. They're doing at multilateral level, 160 countries. But it's going to be very unwieldy. Getting everyone of those 160 to agree, even a single point, is so difficult. This the climate, you know, it's been going on for 18 years, negotiation on climate change. Yeah? Hopefully, they'll reach an agreement in the next few hours. Yeah? 190 countries gathered now in Paris. They want to make sure that temperature will not go up beyond 1.5 degrees Celsius. And if that happens, I was told, if it's 2 degrees, 250 million people will have to move somewhere. If it's 1.5 degrees, it will be about 150 million, half of it. So it makes a lot of difference. 1.5 and 2 degrees Celsius. It's a very critical decision. We consider that Paris and Malaysia is a very strong supporter of the negotiations, hope that there will be a good outcome in Paris in the next few hours. I think that's all to say. Looking at my watch, I've got to do some light checking, but anyway, I can have time for probably two or three questions. Okay? And I open the floor for Q&A.
Right, thank you, Dr. Pa, for the insightful speech. A round of applause, guys. So now we open the floor to 3 questions. State your name and organization and forward to the mics for any questions for Dr. Pa. So can we have the first question, please?
Okay, want to say something? I see, yes. Okay. Okay. Can I be excused? Ada. Oh, that's one. Okay. You with you've been to my house, right? Come. Who's been to my house? Who's been to my house? Oh, quite a few been to my house. And that was about TPP as well, right? My house was about TPP as well. Okay.
Thank you very much, Representative Sabah Muhammad, for having us today. We are truly grateful, we are truly honored to be given this opportunity without the support of MIPI, as well as even KBS. We wouldn't have the resources, the guidance, the advice to carry out such a, from our point of view, such a very complex and technical issue. I mean, everyone would agree that from this program, we learn a lot compared to when we started in the morning. And I think without that support, we wouldn't be able to do this. I'm also, we would like, on behalf of the committee also, we would like to appreciate or be very grateful with all the other youth organizations who participate in today's event. I mean, you guys wouldn't have a reason, you wouldn't really have a reason to come here. But for the sake of, you know, trying to contribute to the country, trying to give your ideas, your input, trying to better understand the issues that is very pertinent for our country, you guys spend time, your organizations really helped in getting those delegates. People from AMK, people from DEPC, people from YCM, UMNO, all the organizations really helped us in getting the participants on board. Without your help and support, we wouldn't be able to get this crowd. So we're really truly grateful for everyone to be here, and we hope that in the future we will have more sessions like this, you know, youth roundtable. Roundtable is focused on youth needs, youth views, to highlight our voice as one, rather than having small groups or small sentiment sections within youth, but to actually have a stronger youth voice. I mean, that's how we move forward to become the next generation leaders. So I hope this is not the end. Hopefully this is the beginning, and hope everyone in our future event. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So this will be a lot more. Before I ask this gentleman to ask this question, I want young people to be fair, objective and balanced. That's important. Fair, objective, balanced. I mean, many of these guys who have been posting all kinds of things in cyberspace, I think some of them are irresponsible. Some of them, of course, they fair comment, yeah? But when you spin, I mean, when it's inaccurate, when you know it is inaccurate. For example, they started, they said, with TPP, there is no more halal. We cannot use the Jakim halal logo. That's a lie. I mean, there's a paragraph in TPP to say that Malaysia may continue to use this halal logo. But these guys keep on saying, with TPP, I was in the Dewan Negara. Dewan Negara, these are senators, you know. One senator, I was there to answer a question, got up and asked me, yeah, is it true that with TPP, Malaysia cannot trade with Muslim countries anymore? Malaysia has to trade with Israel. I'm question coming from senator. Senator, yeah, that was last week, that was Wednesday. Is it true that with TPP, Malaysia cannot do trade with Muslim countries anymore? Malaysia would be forced to trade with Israel. Those are the kind of questions on the ground. Huh? This is dirty tactic, hitting you to the gut. This is unfair. So I want you to be fair, balanced. Okay. I mean, I welcome fair criticism. I'm, you know, many of you know me, I'm open. I'm open to ideas, open to criticism. Huh? I'm not someone who is fixed my views. I listen, I think I'm good listener. Eh? I see some of you nodding, but many of you are not saying anything. Eh? So, but I hope I'm being fair. Eh? So I beg you to be fair, objective and fair. I welcome criticism, and some of them are perfectly legitimate, but if it is, you know, deliberately lying, and you know, I don't like that. Yes.
Assalamualaikum, sir. My question is just to ask for your insight and opinion. I'm a student. My name is Burhan. When I've learned about the TPP only today, and what
today?
Yeah, only today. And so my question is that, since you mentioned it's a catalyst for transparency and being accountable, but I also see it as a transparency for like encouraging better education and creativity among the young people. Like you urge the young people to be more globalized. So I want to know, after we are part of this, do we expect drastic or maybe dramatic changes in our education system in order to keep up with the other nation? Thank you, sir.
Okay. I was once higher education minister, so I know a bit about university. Education, I mean, TPP, of course it will facilitate. But education has got to do with domestic policy. Yeah? TPP can be a catalyst to bring about reform and changes. But education, talk about quality, you know all this ranking. I'll share you a story. Anyone here from UCM there? Quite a few, I'm sure. Anyway, the first time ranking came out, UCM Malaya was top 189, by the way. So they have billboards and banners in UCM Malaya to celebrate the success of UCM Malaya, top 100 universities in the world. And then later, I attended a seminar in Hong Kong. The company doing this ranking, they had a seminar in Hong Kong. I went with, at that time, Charif Hafsa was working with me, the VC of UKM. Yeah? She was CEO of MQA. Yeah? MQA, she came with me. And they admitted they were wrong, because they counted Indians and Chinese as foreign students. Yeah? Under the Times Higher, if you have lecturers who are foreigners or students of foreigners, that I think the weightage 20%, that indicates how global you are, So I'm just sharing with you this anecdote. So what happened the following year, UCM Malaya came down because of this error that they did. So anyway, sometimes you can do well because people can break mistakes. So UCM Malaya did well because this guy created this mistake. But anyway, to answer your question, I think national policy, which meritocracy and research. And if you ask me, there are three categories of students in our university. I mean, not just in Malaysia, anywhere in the world. The top 10%, they are global. Whether you're in Malaya, UKM, UIA, you are global. You can work in New York, and quite a few in Singapore, Australia, highly marketable. And then you have those in the middle, about 30-40%. Our biggest worry is the bottom big and bottom 40. These are people who lack the skills, who do not have the confidence, who can't speak a second language. That's our biggest worry. So when we talk about education, I'm not worried about the top 10%. You can put them in any environment, they can accept. They are global students, and there are many of them. Many examples of students who have done well here and overseas. And then those in the middle, they've done okay. My biggest worry, if you ask me about education, the biggest worry is how to improve the quality of the bottom 40%. So the B40 is everywhere. The B40s in Kuala Lumpur, the urban poor, the B40s in Sabah and Sarawak, the B40s university students. Okay, so thank you so much. I'm glad that I think you have enjoyed the session.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dato' Sri. Ladies and gentlemen.
So, saya, I want to declare you as ambassadors of the government of Malaysia. Boleh? Boleh, eh? To help us to promote TPP. Boleh, eh? Siapa setuju lah, kan? Who among you agree to be our ambassador? For free. Who wants to be paid? And anyway, thank you so much. Yeah? And I think we want some of you to be in this meeting we're having with student leaders. This is a public and private meeting. It's either Monday or Tuesday next week. Yeah? And then we're going to have many, many more. And I'm going to have one town hall, one more. We had one here where I was alleged to have made a sexist remark. You read the story, yeah? And I apologize that the star full of praise from you. Lah. Blessing this guy. We're going to have it here as well. Lah. Town hall, somewhere in the middle of the Edwin. We're going to have it here as well. You're most welcome. You can accommodate with 2,000 people there. I mean, the more the merrier. So, terima kasih. All the best. Thank you once again. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Dato' Sri. Now, we would like to welcome Mr. Johan, Mr. Sharizan, and Mr. Koyum to present the momentous document and a token of appreciation to Dato' Sri Mustafa Mohammed. Please welcome.